All right. So, welcome to today's lecture performance. I was originally invited to this exhibition by Ruben, with kind of the back thought also to bring a more research-based approach into this exhibition, because that's kind of what I do, I guess. And this building has quite a rich history, or a conflicted history as well. As you may have noticed, it's within the Langstrasse quartier, where sex work is slowly pushed out of this area, and the city of Zurich is really trying to bring sex workers into just small spaces that are really designated for sex work, but not have it in areas that are being gentrified and areas that, you know, where people are trying to invest a lot of money and make it more socially acceptable areas, kind of. And so I was thinking about mainly about the act of how sex workers are influenced by gentrification, because I think it's an industry we don't really think about when we think of gentrification. And it's not really my approach to try to tell the exact story of a place. I didn't feel like I could do it justice to talk about this, you know, the specific people that lived here, because those rooms that we're in, they used to be rooms where people lived, and as far as we could find out, some of those people were sex workers. Now, the sources we have are all a bit contradictory, so we don't really know why they had to move out. Some say it's because they couldn't pay the rent, because of COVID, because they didn't make enough money. Others say they were pushed out anyway, because this building is actually going to be torn down in like 3 weeks or so. Like, right after we close the exhibition, the building is going to be demolished. And then I was thinking that I wanted to concentrate on this topic of sex workers being pushed out of spaces, but also implemented in the areas that I'm already thinking about. And while I'm not like a digital native, you could maybe call me a like digitally adopted person, I spend a ridiculous amount of time on the internet, and it's only been like a year that I started to spend it a bit more consciously or seriously, and that I started to understand that spending time on the internet can also mean to observe societal structures that kind of reflect the structures that are within society anyway, but they are portrayed somehow differently on the internet. So I started researching how sex workers would actually use internet space, how it would enable them to maybe find a platform to talk about their own reality, because sex work is often treated as an industry where people are not able themselves to talk about what they experience, but people feel like they need to talk about those people. So maybe it would be a platform where people could find their own voice and their own chance kind of to do their own history writing and to tell the actual reality that they experience. And another part of it was, you know, you could also say, why didn't you just talk directly to sex workers, which kind of is where that meme comes in. I'm not in the moment in the financial position to compensate someone for the work that they give me, and especially if it's a marginalized group, if someone is to educate you on their experience, I think it is only normal that you try to financially compensate them, which I cannot at the moment. So I found refuge in the internet and the already, because there are many, many accounts that provide free educational stuff. For sex workers, it's apparently really common that people think, oh, I could do something about sex work, and then they're like, can I please interview you and do it for free? So while I was starting this research, I realized that there was a lot of debates going on of sex work and pop culture. Now, of course, the history is really rich of pop culture using sex work aesthetics. For example, here we have, I think that was 1993, Madonna's Erotica World Tour, and it basically opened with a stripper or pole dancer. But of course, it goes on into movies, it goes on into music videos, it goes on into fashion, like fashion really takes a lot of inspiration from sex workers. So what I didn't want to do though is to do a like history painting, but I wanted to be very much in 2020. So pretty much at the start of when I started scrolling through Instagram a bit differently, I discovered that there was a huge debate going on about FK twigs. Like, it was really feverish. And so on the 16th of July, Vixen Temple blog, that's an Instagram user who's a sex worker from New Zealand, a stripper, and also an online sex worker, who uses their Instagram platform very much as an educational space, posts this sort of educational slide, which you might be familiar with, because Instagram has really gotten more political over the past few months, also with, you know, the popularization of the Black Lives Matter movement. We've seen many of those educational slides. So she made this slide about FK twigs and the savior mentality. And she writes, basically as a description of that slide, why sex workers, so SW stands for sex workers, which we will see many, many times in the next 1.5 hours, are tired of celebrities using our livelihoods to further their own narratives. I do not wish to cancel FK twigs, and I do not encourage sending hate in her direction. This slideshow is for educational purposes, to provide an insight into why our sex workers, especially strippers, are disappointed in her at the moment. And she lists some sources as well. Now, what's quite interesting is that when I was roaming the internet, is that some kinds of sex work are really visible and others are not. So there is, which might be explainable by this kind of diagram, which is called the whorearchy. So it's basically the hierarchy within sex work communities. So it is both a hierarchy that sex workers treat other sex workers with, but it's also one that is projected from the outside, from civilian people. So this pyramid, I kind of did following an interview with a sex worker from Australia, and she described that street-based sex workers are really regarded as like the lowest people, kind of, and then brothel workers are a bit better, and then rug and tub workers and erotic masseuses. Rug and tub workers especially means basically massages but with a happy ending, so massages with a hand job. Then we've got escorting. Strippers are kind of in the middle, but strippers are really visible. Like, if you go onto Instagram, if you go onto Twitter, etc., strippers are really kind of what you see, that are using the platforms. And I think also if you see if you watch movies and music videos, it's also the culture that's kind of appropriated the most, be it with, you know, the pleaser shoes, be it with just pole dancing in general. Then on top of that, we have porn stars, then BDSM mistresses, cam girls or cam boys, persons. We have phone sex workers, and at the very top, the sugar babies, because they're kind of the closest to the idea of monogamy, because you're kind of, you play the role of being in a relationship with someone, a seemingly monogamous relationship, just as a side note. So going back to her educational slide, Vixen Temple blog describes who FK twigs is, because I don't know if you're familiar with her. FK twigs original name is Talia Debrett Burnett, and is known professionally as FK Twigs, stylized as FK Twigs, and is an English singer and songwriter. With 16, she began performing as a singer in youth clubs before moving to London to pursue a career as a dancer. She's mostly known for her genre-bending musical style that can be defined loosely as electronic, avant-pop, and art pop. She describes her music as, "I found my own way of playing punk. I like industrial sounds and incorporating everyday life sounds like a car alarm." FK twigs is also really known for having a really, really strong work ethics and perfecting crafts. Like, for example, in her newest video, Saturday, she performs wushu, which is a specific kind of Chinese martial art, which is basically kung fu style fighting, but with swords and with fans, and she would train that for years with, you know, like high-end professionals. Right. So FK twigs and pole, which is another thing she really perfectionized. FK Twigs has become known for her pole dancing skills from her 2019 video Cellophane. According to her pole instructor, Kelly Yvonne, Twigs started training for pole in December of 2016. According to Yvonne, Twigs initially wanted to learn to pole dance for an ad campaign she was directing. Once immersed in the discipline, however, she began envisioning a variety of ways to integrate pole into her visual narrative. Now that's one explanation. In the first post that Twigs posted on Instagram where she's pole dancing, and there were many to follow, I think that was May 2018, she also described that she had to undergo surgery as she had fibroid tumours, and that the surgery made her feel very uncomfortable in her body and very weak, and that through pole dancing she found some sort of healing, or that she refound self-confidence in her body. And she would later also say that she picked up pole dancing just for the Cellophane video and trained like 1 year just for that choreography. Oops, that comes later, sorry. So, talking about that video, Cellophane, which we're going to watch in a second, this video really was critically acclaimed. It was, I think, published in April 2019 as the first single of her new album, Magdalene, called after Mary Magdalene. And it won Best Song of the Year, I think, by Pitchfork, and it won different awards for the music video. So we're just going to give it a watch to get into her aesthetics.
Don't you They're watching us, they're waiting and hoping I'm not enough.
So we're going to go back to the slideshow of Vixen Temple blog, and I just want to insert that I'm really centering this lecture around posts that are made by actual sex workers, because I really wanted to avoid bringing in theory from other people. I wanted to get this very direct storytelling, and I also didn't want to consume it myself and tell it to you freely, because that again would be like my own reproduction of it and not the direct kind of storytelling of people who actually experience these things. So Vixen Temple goes on and writes, celebrities stealing aesthetics from strip club culture and using sex workers as props to further their own narrative. In her video for Cellophane, Twix was wearing pleasers. Pleasers are a brand of shoes designed specifically for strippers to be able to perform comfortably and effectively in strip clubs. Pleasers are a cultural icon amongst the sex work community, but in recent years they have been incorporated into the world of pole dance and pole fitness. So even in Cellophane, we actually see that within, I think, the first 30 seconds, we actually get a close-up of the pleasers. And I mean, in every movie, in every video, if you get a close-up of something, it means it's important. So there is a clear focus on she's actually wearing pleasers. There is a very direct link to the stripper community and not just pole dancing as this whole fitness thing, which is something that really has been popularized over the past years. And it's also where slut shaming comes back in. So another phenomenon that has occurred on Instagram over the past few years is the hashtag not a stripper, where basically pole dancers are posting footage of themselves dancing on the pole and tagging it with hashtag not a stripper, which goes beyond appropriation and just doing the moves that strippers cultivated and perfectioned, but it actively says that I don't want to be associated with strip culture. It actively says this is a bad thing, I do not want to be associated with that, I'm only doing it for the fitness purpose. Now, as basically all hashtags function, of course there was a counter hashtag being yes, a stripper, where strippers would kind of reclaim that thing and be out and proud and post footage of themselves and being like, yeah, I'm a stripper, that's okay if I am one. For example, she would say exotic pole dance is not stripping. But historically, stripping originated actually from Chinese pole, which funnily enough originated in India. I don't know why exactly it's called Chinese pole, but essentially it's very ancient, it goes back, I think, 800 years, and it's those two poles that you sometimes would see in circus nowadays, and it was mostly men, probably only men, because in India for a long time there were only men allowed to do a lot of things, that would defy gravity on those poles and would jump back and forth and do the like human flag thing and stuff. So that's basically where it started, and then in around 1900, strip culture began to happen, kind of, in America, and there would be those traveling shows where women would dance sensually with poles. And from then on, it would be perfectionized in clubs, in brothels, and so on. So the moves that those pole dancers do that claim to do it just for fitness purposes are originating in strip culture. And yeah, also the pleasers are something like, if you claim that you only do it for fitness purposes, interestingly, a lot of pole dancers still use those shoes. So they're still using that sex appeal aesthetics for it. And this was actually a video I found where they would also share hacks, because I don't know how pleasers feel when you have them on, but I assume they're not the most comfortable thing ever in the world. And so, for example, here we have this hack where they roughen up the surface at the bottom of the shoe and fix it with hairspray so they are not as slippery on the ground as they are when they're new. So TikTok as well was being used by strict workers just to educate themselves or give tips to each other. Celebrity stealing aesthetics from, like, the same title as before, from strip culture. While Twig showcased her pole skills and took them to their Instagram, as we saw before, many sex workers were mindful. We see celebrities glamorize strip club culture all the time. In music videos, wearing out pleasers and outfit, J-Lo performing pole at the 2020 Super Bowl halftime. However, they always fail to acknowledge the community they are stealing their visuals from. So J-Lo was also part of the movie called Hustlers that was published in 2018 that tells the story of a group of strippers that had to survive in the financial crisis in 2008, and sort of found refuge in illegal methods and drugging people and stealing their money, which kind of paints, again, a very negative image of sex workers. And in 2020, she took the whole thing also to one of the most viewed shows in the world, I think, the Super Bowl. So there comes in the savior mentality, and also where the whole controversy really started with FK Twix. So FK Twix recently caused a controversy among the sex work community when she released her short film We Are the Women, Women Written with X. While describing this film, Twix stated, "I decided to hold the second part of the all-female and femme sacred moon dance at Blue Flame. Firstly, to honour the heritage of pole dancing, but also to create a matriarchal dominance in a space that usually is filled with and run by male energy. The heritage of pole dance cannot be celebrated without acknowledging strippers. Pole fitness classes incorporate a lot of moves that would not exist without black strippers. It was black sex workers who brought common moves such as twerking and isolating into pole. They are the reason we have pole today as we know it. But where's the acknowledgement from Twix? Instead, we were met with a very patronizing savior mentality from a civilian woman who has never worked as a stripper. To create a matriarchal dominance in a space that's usually filled with and run by male energy feeds into the common narrative that women who work as sex workers are being exploited by men. It implies that our strippers need an outside influence to come in and rescue us. It implies that we cannot create a sacred feminine space without the help of a woman who isn't a stripper. It implies that strippers can't create a matriarchy because we are the result of exploitation from male energy. That is far from true, and I, for one, am sick of this narrative." Sex workers face censorship from FOSTA and SESTA, which is something I'll explain in a bit. "We are silenced just for existing. While celebrities like J-Lo and FK Twix are rewarded for creating art that we create every day, they do not get deleted from Instagram for promoting their work that is dripping with stripper accessories. The general public worships them as goddesses, queens, artists. Yet when strippers do what J-Lo and Twix do, we are threatened and harassed. We are slut-shamed, denied houses because we don't have a real job, ignored by society as a whole. We are sick of our lifestyle being used as a prop by celebrities who refuse to use their platform to bring attention to the issues we face. This is why we are pissed. Sex workers are tired of being silenced. Our voices are ignored, our stories are hijacked by celebrities with no experience in the sex work industry. Listen to real sex workers. Stop letting celebrities glamorize and profit of our lifestyle without acknowledging us. This is our lives. These are our stories they are stealing from. Stop silencing sex workers. Now, of course, when FK Twigs posted that video, sex workers wouldn't just refuge to their own sites, but they would also comment on the post by FK Twigs herself. So, for example, Jamie Prince wrote, "Trans people are dancers too, this is erasure," referring to the title of We Are the Women. "Yo, please, please watch the stories of Pretty Boy Girl. Twigs has deleted over 40 different people reposting Selena's original comment. An eyeball to camera called her simply a tourist." Tourist being like, you're a tourist in our culture and then you're leaving again. And on the second, that's still the same post, but the second slide, Google Gaga Pastor Booth commented, "LMAO, stop deleting actual black sex worker comments. If you're going to exploit their work, you better be able to talk back." So back here, there has been the mention of Pretty Boy Girl. And on Fair site, they actually has a story highlight called FK Pole Tourism. Which we're going to dive into a bit to understand what happened in that comment section. So Faye calls it unpopular opinion time. "You know how I feel about FK and all the celebrities using pole dance for artistic expression, liberation or fitness. I'm not here for it 95% of the time, unless these celebs are actually talking about issues that are important to strippers' lives and livelihoods. You can't just play cultural tourism through marginalized groups, yeah? She's a talented musician and dancer, but she's also using the strip club as a background she can pop herself into to benefit from the edginess of what for so many people is a very concrete reality with gravity and consequences. They think that they are reclaiming the space, taking it for women. And don't get me started about how whack it is to assume only women work at strip clubs. They assume that's what we want, and in doing so, reenact the paternalism they claim to be fighting against. Where in her timeline has she been there for us? Where has she said our names, talked to us, shared our Venmo or PayPal links when we've been homeless? Has she shown off the skills of any of her stripper mentors on her timeline? Are they visibly plucked? Where has she leveraged any of her power and privilege to help in a real way? I know this is controversial and I listen to FK's music, but we need to expect more of our cultural icons." So anyway, I commented this on her video, per usual. If you want to boost my voice, that would be dope. Here is the post. So that's the same post that we just saw before. And Pretty Boy Girl commented, "This isn't matriarchal dominance. This is talking over the people you're talking about. Making assertions as if we can't speak about ourselves and our work. If you think strip clubs are all about patriarchal dominance, you've never spent time talking to strippers. And we aren't all women. We are trans, NB, and male-identifying people. This is erasure. It's also like your culture vulturing, having a little fun pretending to be a stripper while real strippers could use a person like you, elevating our voices in what we actually need. Fair working conditions, an end to harmful legislation that censors us, while people like you can pole dance without worry. And all of the other things we're actually expressing, but you're focusing on some sense of personal healing and using our space to go on your spiritual journey. This is not what feminism looks like." And then, as we've been hinted at before, her fake comment was actually taken down twice. So Pretty Boy Girl writes that, "I tried posting again to see if it was a glitch, but it's gone. If you're interested in spamming her, reposting what I wrote, I'll DM you the original message." So additionally, it looks like FK Twigs deleted the comments of Teddy, another black sex worker. And Teddy wrote, "You're going to delete comments from sex workers, really. You came into the club I used to work at and took up space and used our workplace as a performing venue while not personally compensating any of the girls you were using as set dressing. Then when our club fired all of us and we unionized, where were you? You want to wear the pleasers and twirl around the pole, but are silent on the issues our community currently faces, tourism at its finest. Black sex workers in Portland are striking. Black sex worker collective is organizing. Dancers are out of work and unable to access unemployment or stimulus payments. Our community is hurting and you can't even throw us a bone as you use our aesthetics for clout." So what's mentioned here, I think, is really important, that sex workers themselves are organizing, that they're unionizing, because, you know, the generally painted image, especially in mainstream media, is that those people are victims and that other people have to speak up for themselves. But there are actually various organizations where sex workers come together and try to empower each other. So one of them is Soldiers of Pole, which is an organization based in the US. And they call themselves a labor movement of sanctuary strippers with standards higher than our heels. Another very interesting format that they actually have on their Instagram page is they have a so-called stripper news break. So they have this whole IGTV live streams where they would just talk about news that concerns sex workers in the US. So they would talk about maybe fatalities that happened, they would talk about strikes that were happening and so on. So really just news flash focusing on that. And if we head to their website, you can also see what their mission is: to provide education, to unionize clubs, to protect sex workers, uphold integrity within our organization, and to promote visibility and destigmatization. And so it goes on, and the censorship also go on. So Pretty Boy Girl writes that, "I know at least 40 people reposted my original text and every instance has been deleted. How do you know if your comment was deleted? Check for likes, you may still see your comment, but if we haven't liked it, it's only visible to you." That's actually quite interesting. We'll see that multiple times, that sex workers actually often understand more of how social media platforms work than like the average person, because they're so affected by censorship that they really have to understand how those structures work. And for example, how shadow banning works, which is basically that you're still allowed to post, but no one's going to see it because it's not going to feed into the normal algorithmic timeline. So you'll think that you're still posting normally, but no one's going to see it on their timeline. I'm going to skip that, actually. Right. So I think after all those comments, it makes sense to watch the actual video everyone is talking about. Although I think the point that rocked the sex work community the most was the statement about the matriarchal dominance and the male energy. So this is We Are the Women, which was posted in July 2020.
A woman's work, a woman's prerogative, a woman's time to embrace, she must put herself first. A woman's touch, a sacred geometry. I know where you start, where you end, how to please, how to curse. This centerpiece is about resurrecting the women. Because if you elevate the women, you elevate the family. Then we can all transform and birth a new world. We're gonna do a dance. And we're gonna do it as one. These movements are based on movements from the first healers at the beginning of civilization. Whatever movement you make is perfect because it's your language. Now you speak about your rebirth.
Ginger Baby is way better because I'm gonna just swoop this up and that's it. You did the like the whole chili shit.
No, Twigs, can you give me some baby hairs?
When
I said cowboy, my name was Bambi.
That's cute.
That's Bambi.
I'm fucking with Bambi. I'm fucking with that.
Yeah.
What about y'all? Y'all feeling
that's
that?
Cute. Bambi's good.
Okay, that's your new stripper name, Bambi.
That's
I
like you. Bambi. We've just before talked about the very active censorship happening on social media. And also, Pretty Boy Girl posted that I'm afraid my account is being censored and that I'll go to Instagram jail. I noticed a lot of the original posts from the FK story in my highlights stopped showing the number of views, so I think they've been erased. It's not surprising. All the sex workers I know have gotten their accounts restricted, taken down, or shadow banned. It's that easy to erase us. It's that easy to silence our voices when we speak up. This is why we need allies. And I mean, just a few examples of that phenomena of being silenced. So, for example, Vixen Temple blog, the account we looked at like the first account, got this warning that her account may be deleted, and it's shown that two posts were removed, one for nudity or sexual activity, and her comment is simply, "Yeah, Instagram, I know you hate sex workers." As well as Hayley Hazen Uncensored, I have a feeling my account might get deleted because YouTube celebrities have control over Instagram, so please follow Hayley Hazen, my backup. The whole YouTube celebrity thing is that was another discussion we'll come to later with Bella Thorne, actually. And so a common strategy is to have multiple accounts, so if one gets deleted, it isn't as bad. And to encourage people to follow all of them, which of course never happens. You always have this one big account, and then the very, very loyal followers will follow the second account as well. But so what I actually thought about is that it might reconnotate the phrase of digital nomads in another way that I actually find more appropriate. Like, digital nomad is a term for those vloggers on YouTube that do, like, they are traveling the world and they are also working while traveling the world. So they're basically surviving off traveling the world. But I found digital nomad actually to be much more fitting for sex workers because they're constantly pushed out of one space and have to go to another to survive. So FK Twigs somehow had to react because she got so many comments, she had to delete many comments, and there were just... there was a whole uproar happening, and there were also, you know, articles being published and so on. And so what she did is she posted on the 4th of August her own outing, as that she has previously worked as a sex worker. And she wrote, "I was 19 when I learned my first pole move. I learned a backhook spin from a stripper when I was working as a hostess in a gentleman's club. For those of you who don't know, hostessing is when one person pays another person for their time. Anything from a conversation over dinner to sex work, and the club gets a cut of the fee. My lived experience as a very young woman in these environments has not only informed the strong and formidable woman that I am today, but also a lot of my work as a music and visual artist, sometimes even subconsciously. I feel like now is the time for me to step forward, pay respect, and shine a light on the challenges facing sex workers, especially during these uncertain times. Sex workers I know and have met have discipline, craft, talent, and work ethic. Not only do they deserve better long term, but their income has been wiped out by the lockdown and many are invisible to the financial aid available to others. There's a bigger journey in challenging public attitudes, tackling stigma, and fighting for rights and protections. But today I'm inviting you to join me in helping with cash donations to Swarm, Lysistrata, and ELSC. These organizations are providing direct financial support to strippers and sex workers. We've kicked off the fund with £10,000, and you can donate at the following link. And this week, Swarm, Melissa Strata and ELSC will also be taking over my social media channels. Sorry. So, I mean, that's quite the change in giving a platform. But also what happened here is that some sex workers felt really uncomfortable with the fact that twigs had to out herself. So you talk about outing yourself just as you talk about outing yourself in the LGBTQ community, because for a lot of sex workers, it is not safe to be out to their family, to their friends, to, if they have another workplace, to that workplace. So some sex workers said that the whole pressure that was being put onto FK Twigs led to another sex worker having to out themselves, which is something they never really want to pressure someone to do. So I'm going to show you a small excerpt from a live stream that Vixen Temple blog did, where she talks about, on one side, about that calling out thing, and also that FK Twigs actually reached out to her personally.
It's very ambiguous what kind of sex work she did, and that's why I had some issues with people saying, well, implying that we forced her to out herself, but... one, I didn't want that at all. I never said that she had to come forward as a sex worker. You look at Kalani, you don't have to be a sex worker to be a good ally to us. You just have to acknowledge that it's hard, acknowledge that it's difficult right now with foster sister, credit the dancers, you know, treat us as people, not as props. Again, as an artist, FK Twigs has every right to portray the strip club in the way that she thinks speaks her truth. But the problem there is that it does feed into a damaging narrative that is scary for us strippers. But I was self-inserting myself as of someone that reports on what happens in the sex work industry. That's the point of my blog. I do this all the time. I keep everyone posted on things that are in relation to sex work. And then I got dragged into this massive conversation and I saw Pretty Boy Girl posted on Faye's story saying that Faye were in discussion with FK Twigs, that Faye were on the phone with them, and I was like, oh thank goodness, Selena's perfect to handle this, I am not equipped for this, we are in good hands. But anyway, so Pretty Boy Girl said that Faye were on the phone with FK Twigs, I went, oh thank goodness, they might be able to reach a resolution, awesome, I'm happy about this. And then... I'm sitting on my phone, I'm about to put it down and go make myself some breakfast, and on the top of my screen, FKA Twigs, and I just went, oh no, like, oh no, I immediately just my heart sunk, I was like, oh no, like I've just woken up, I'm not ready for this. So I had commented on the Ethical Strippers post saying, look, I appreciate the acknowledgement, I think it's very convenient that FKA Twigs left out the part about some dancers being fired from a club that she promoted her music at, and they reached out to FKA Twigs and heard nothing back. So when FKA Twigs messaged me, they said, hey, what girls did I get fired? What are you talking about? I said, oh no, this is just based on information I was provided by Pretty Boy Girl, is that strippers at the Cheetah's Lounge were fired. They changed management and they reached out to you because you had just filmed there for help and you didn't get back to them. And then FK Twigs said, can I call you? But I said, sure, let's talk. Maybe it'll, you know, ear some things out and give some clarity to the situation. But my intuition was telling me that Twigs didn't really understand what they'd done wrong, because... but I am a sex worker, so, like, what was I supposed to do? And that frustrated me because Selena especially had given so many examples of things that you can do. You can speak for sex workers. You can use your platform of almost 2 million followers and the whole world, because you are a celebrity, to talk about how hard it is to be a sex worker, how dangerous it is when there is negative narratives painted off us that they are now contributing to. Yes, it is FKA Twigs art and they have every right to portray it in the way that they want to, But when you are representing a minority, a marginalized group, you have to be careful how you go about that. And Selena the Stripper offered so many resolutions on what FKA Twigs could have done better. FKA Twigs claims that she had nothing to do with the comments being deleted, that her Instagram account monitors particular words and doesn't let those words be posted. But there's a bit of a... So you can do that. You can, in your comment sections, like, have words that you type in that if someone tries to comment that word, the comment automatically doesn't get posted. So the comment wouldn't be there in the first place to be deleted. And I said, so did you not delete the comment? She goes, no, I have no idea. Like, I don't spend my time going through my Instagram deleting comments. Fair. I said, perhaps your PR team. No, I don't have a PR team. I do everything myself. I run my own stuff. Okay, great. Good for you. That's pretty cool. So do I. but yeah, she's very adamant that she didn't delete any of the comments, which is really suspicious to me because she said maybe her fans reported the comments, but if they'd been reported and taken down, Selena the Stripper would have gotten a notification saying that their comments been removed. That didn't happen. So that's still suspicious. That's still... guess we'll never know, right?
So essentially, it's quite uncommon for a celebrity to actually reach out personally to people that criticize them. But it seems that it still remained a conversation that was mostly centered around FK Twigs and her not having done anything wrong and not her actively listening. But she talked to Vixen Templeblock personally and also to Pretty Boy Girl, and also in a video call with the two, and also Black Venus in Furs, which is that person right here, who has written a very articulate article on her... No, it was not her blog, it was another blog, but like this really long blog post about FK Twigs and appropriation of strip culture. And so I think there were a lot of mixed feelings. So Pretty Boy Girl commented this screenshot with, a lot has happened this week, but I think we're all with our intentions in the right place. Venus, Vixen, Twigs and I all had a very vulnerable chat because things truly got out of hand and a lot of hurtful misconceptions have been flying around about everyone. I want to say that this doesn't happen often. We haven't seen J-Lo respond to what Hustlers did to that club in New York City, and Ilana literally never said anything about her Fuck the Pause campaign imagery. Just quickly inserting here with what Hustlers did to that club in New York City. So Hustlers, the movie, J-Lo was part of that I spoke about at the beginning. And essentially what happened there is that they rented out a strip club, which you can do with mostly big strip clubs, or those that are like chains and have different spots. But what happens if when you rent out a strip club, that the strippers that work there, they cannot go to work and they have absolutely no financial compensation. So during the time of filming the movie, people weren't able to work and they got no compensation. So that's what Faye are talking about here. Twigs actually is showing up and talking, and I have to give her props for that because it is not an easy conversation. If you have questions, please ask me for clarification. And to be clear, this has always been about the macro issue of sex workers, our image, and what responsibility one has when harnessing it in an artistic medium. So we're all going to take a break and release a statement soon about what the future looks like. I would have never imagined this storm would have grown to this proportion. I think it's just hit upon something sex workers have been struggling to verbalize for a while. Our image is powerful and must be used responsibly. Anyway, hope you enjoy our makeup-free realness. So apparently the whole discussion around FK Twigs is something that triggered a lot, that, you know, happens all the time, but it really densed up with that particular conversation. And so FK Twigs did what she promised, is that she would make this Instagram takeover. And I think it was 2 or 3 days that she would give her account with the 2 million followers to different collectives to post educational content. And I'm just going to show you a few. So one is Ethical Stripper, one is United Strippers of the World. this was, who was that? I'm not sure, sorry. basically talking about London and about the intersection of strip culture and artistry. And there were actually quite a few. So this one is also still from the takeover. But what's really interesting is that she would lend her platform for those few days, which is big for most celebrities to do. But the next post that we see is this one here, which is her quite recent collaboration with 645AR. I'm not sure how his name really is pronounced, but he's a musician. And, sorry?
69.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, and so there she totally goes back into the sex work aesthetics, as we're going to see right now. There wasn't as much reaction to find from sex workers online, and I kind of assume that maybe the energy ran a bit out because it was such a long process. Like, it, you know, the uproar kind of started in mid-July, and this, I think, was, it was like 1 month of like really battling online and to get this exposure, and to this video I couldn't find much reaction. But so, like, personally I have a bit mixed feelings of like, you know, she does this one step forward and then still goes on with the aesthetic. But this kind of concludes the FK Twigs section. And this is also where I'm going to ask you whether you would like to take like a 5 to 10 minute break to kind of walk around a bit, take some fresh air, or if you want to continue for the next 30 minutes that I'm going to go a bit. I'm going to explain what Sester Foster is, which has been mentioned. I'm going to go a bit into OnlyFans and in how sex workers team up to create their own structures online. So what's the general feeling?
What's your feeling?
I'm good. So no need for a break?
Cool.
Okay, good. So With this video, we've kind of ended up in this area of online sex work with camming, for example. And especially in 2020, going online for sex work has been really crucial, because most sex workers that would work in real life and in the physical realm, like strip workers, full-service sex workers means the whole penis, vagina, penetration work, they had to find refuge in online work because they were no longer allowed to work in their normal spaces because of COVID and because of lockdowns. And so many strippers and many full-service sex workers went, for example, to OnlyFans, which is probably the most known platform, which you might have heard about as well. And it's basically a platform with the structure that you buy a monthly subscription to the content of someone. So the average pricing, I think, is $15 a month to access what someone posts. But it ranges really from, there are people having monthly subscriptions for $5, there are some that have like $50, so it's a quite a wide range. And so one thing is the monthly subscription you have, and you access the content that they provide, like videos, photos, you can chat with them, but also you can get more exclusive content if you tip them. So if there is this direct, like more VIP content, where you give them a tip, let's say $100, $200, and you get something really specific just for you. And so this is kind of where we go into another pop person or a celebrity, which is Bella Thorne. And Soldiers of Paul, the organization we've seen earlier, posted this a few weeks ago with the title "This Week in Celebrities Gentrifying Sex Work Featuring Bella Thorne." So what happened is that Bella Thorne joined OnlyFans, and as Hayley Hazen Uncensored posted, many sex workers weren't able to send clients videos on that particular day because the site crashed as Bella Thorne was joining. So the demand, or like the traffic on the page, increased so much that it just shut down, which means a full day where people couldn't sell their stuff. But that's just one thing. Let's skip this one, sorry. That's just one thing. I'm going to dive into the repercussions of what she did later. But first, Jamie Sis Smiling wrote, "The way my gut plummeted when I read this. This feels like the Caroline Calloway madness all over again on a magnified scale. I'm all for Bella Thorne's sexual liberation and expression, and we cannot morally condemn her or anyone else for choosing to start an OnlyFans. I do think it's important for Bella's fan base, mostly young women from her Disney years, to have sex-positive role models, and I hope she takes time to address this on her platform, because she has the unique opportunity to challenge stigma surrounding sex work on her younger, impressionable audience. At the same time, the optics of someone on her platform and privilege starting an OnlyFans are almost an act of violence towards people who rely on OnlyFans as their only source of income. She will be taking away so many clients from less famous sex workers when she truly does not need the money the same way they do. I want Bella Thorne to take her OnlyFans platform and promote as many other sex workers as possible, hire sex work advocates to educate on her OnlyFans, and donate 99% of the money she makes to sex worker-based organizations and other sex workers. Because when people like Bella and Carolyn and so many others come into the market, it jeopardizes people's livelihoods in this labor force who don't and likely never will have Bella's privilege and platform." So one thing is that she would take away clients, that she would crash the site, but what really left a trace is that she was accused for fraud. So what happened, if we look at this here closer, is this is the format I was talking about, where you buy the exclusive content through tips. So she will promise to sell a nude picture of herself for $200. And what happened is it was nude. So extremely many clients reported her and said they wanted their money back. And as that was so many people, I'm just going to read what's actually written here. Because to report a PPV message was not, so the PPV message meaning this exclusive content, in fact, the nude OnlyFans user requested refunds at such a rate that some creators are claiming it prompted the platform to take changes to how it pays creators. Creators in some countries will now have to wait 30 days, up from 7, to receive payouts. Creators on OnlyFans receive 80% of their subscription revenue and can also receive tips from their fans, a spokesperson for OnlyFans told Vulture in a release. OnlyFans has reportedly since placed a cap on the prices creators can charge for PPV content and on tips. So what happened is that actually the money you were able to spend on those tips went down by 50%. So when before you could spend $200, you were now only able to spend $100. And if you imagine that your day-to-day job would just cut down your salary 50%, that's quite a drastic change. So that was like a really harsh impact on the lives of so many online creators. Fibromarx Alia wrote, sex workers are unable to get pandemic relief because of criminalization and are struggling to get people to spend $5 a month on their content. Meanwhile, a rich celebrity makes 1 million in a day cosplaying as one. So Bella Thorne also broke the record and she made 1 million just in a day, which has never happened before. Give money to working class sex workers, not celebrity LARPers. I'm so fucking tired of this shit. Celebs just profit off of the images of sex workers, can post their OnlyFans link in their timelines and do not give a fuck about real sex workers. Meanwhile, OnlyFans is getting gentrified and kicking off sex workers who depend on the site because we are in a fucking pandemic. So, OnlyFans didn't necessarily start out as a platform just for sex workers, but it was, you could also, I don't know, sell exclusive fitness tutorials and, you know, content, but it was made successful by sex workers. There are also people providing other content, but the content that really made the platform as big is content from sex workers. And of course, it's not just sex workers receiving the money, but also people behind the platform who take, I think, 20% of the money sex workers make. So they get very rich. But what happens, just with the buildings here, is that when it gets to a certain degree of success, that the mainstream comes in, the money comes in, and the celebrities come in. So what's happening to OnlyFans is that sex workers are more and more silenced on the platform itself and are kind of pushed out because they want to use the platform for something else, not as dirty. And I found this Google Doc that was kind of a collection of links where there would be tips on how to navigate online sex work. For example, how do you advertise yourself? How do you link? How do you link different profiles? For example, Twitter is the main advertising platform for OnlyFans. So if you create an OnlyFans account, you can directly link your Twitter to it. So every time you post something, there will be a preview on it on your Twitter. And one of the docs that I found is one that basically describes the word bans on different sites. So we have OnlyFans on here, but we also have Clips for Sale, we have Cam4, Sex Panther, like all kinds of sites where online content is being shared and bought. And some of those words I think make total sense because they prevent potentially harmful content from being distributed, but some are just a bit odd and discriminatory towards sex workers. So for OnlyFans, we have word bans that include abduct, animal, asphyxiate, bait, ball busting, bareback, bestiality, blacked, blackmail, bleed, blood, bukake, canned, caning, cannibal, CBT, cervix, child, chloroform, choke, coma, comatose, constant cycle, diapers, dog, doge, drink, drunk, enema, entrance, escort, escorting, fanfuck, farm, farm sex, fecal, fetal, fist, flogging, forced, forcing, fuck a fan, gangbang, gaping, golden, heart, sports, hooker, hypno, hypnosis, hypnotize, inbreed, incapacitate, incapacitation, incest, intox, intoxicate, jail, jailbird, kidnap, knocked out, lactate, lactation, lolicon, lolita, mariana, medical play, menstruate, molest, mutilate, mutilation, necrophilia, n-word, paddling, paralyzed, past, pee, pee play, pegging, piss, pissing, poop, prostitute, rape, scat, showers, snuff, strangle, suffocate, teen, toilet, torture, trance, unconscious, unwilling, vomit, water sports, whipping, and young. I think water sports is my absolute favorite. I don't know.
Can I say something?
Yes.
Water sports is another word for, like, urinal play.
All right. That's good to know, because I was like, yeah.
Yeah.
That makes much more sense. Yeah. So I found this drawing, which I think sums up what's happening really well. So sex workers are forced to create their own platforms because they're not accepted in structures that already exist. And when they build these structures, other people want to join in, and so they no longer fit in there and are being pushed out.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understood how, like, what are those words exactly?
It's basically if you post your content, and usually you describe your content with different tag words, so people can search for very specific content that they're interested in. And so there are words that are banned, so words that you're not allowed to use on the site, or else your content will get banned as well. And so these words are actually increasing. And what's happening with OnlyFans becoming less hospitable for sex workers is that many sex workers are looking for alternatives. But as it turns out, getting away from OnlyFans is actually pretty hard, as this account describes here. It will take a long time to delete all your posts. A long time. You are generally only allowed to delete 2 posts in a 24-hour period. And as you get closer to deleting all of your content, it will only let you delete 1 post in a 24-hour period. I only had about 20 posts, and it took me over a month to delete everything. Your account will not be fully deleted until your final subscriber's pay cycle has been completed. If your last subscriber bought a year's subscription, then your profile will not be deleted for a whole year. You need to tell your subs that you're planning on deactivating and urge them to turn off their auto-renewals and discourage anyone new from subscribing. If people continue subscribing, you will not be able to delete your page until they stop paying. If your balance is below $20 or whatever the minimum payout is, you will not be able to withdraw it. It's gone. And don't think OnlyFans is above wage theft. When I was trying to deactivate my page, I had about $200 that I attempted to cash out. When I checked it the next day, the balance was $0.81 and I had not been paid. No response. So there are silencing mechanisms that are very particular to a page, like to OnlyFans and their work bans. But there has also been Foster Sesta, which has been referenced to earlier. And I'm just going to throw in some memes here. Foster Sesta essentially is a way of censoring things, like, kind of across the board. And if we go to stopsesta.org, there are some, like, brief facts about what that actually is. So President Trump signed the Allow States and Victims to Fight Online Sex Trafficking Act, FOSTA, in April 2018. This law combined a previous version of FOSTA with the Senate Stop Enabling Sex Traffickers Act, SESTA. Among other things, the new law expands existing federal criminal law to target online platforms where users discuss sex work and related topics. Platform owners can be prosecuted under the expanded law, even in cases where they didn't know that people were using those platforms to engage in sex work, and even in situations where there is no indication of coerced sex trafficking of adults or minors. It opens online platforms to new criminal and civil liability for hosting content about sex work at both the federal and state levels. It changes the law retroactively. An online platform can be prosecuted under federal and state law or held civilly liable for hosting content created before FOSTA was passed. The crushing criminal and civil liability created by the law has incentivized platforms to over-censor their users. When platforms are on the side of censorship, it's marginalized voices that are hit the hardest. So I'm going to show you a brief video where Selena the stripper describes kind of what that means.
before, you know, sex workers were able to post ads online and vet their clients online, they had a lot of databases that could, like, blacklist certain clients who had been abusive, and they could share information a lot more freely. But with the passage of Sesta Pasta, a lot of those resources and databases got shut down. So a lot of predators were back out on the loose to hurt people again without the same protections. And additionally, sex workers were not able to, you know, get clients in the same way online using things like Backpage that provided, you know, a free platform for you to post ads and things like that. So it's behind this paywall, which means that people are, you know, going back into street-based sex work. People are not able to vet clients in the same way. They're having to take on more risks, which hacking and hustling has started to prove is creating, like, an uptick in homicides and other violent assault.
So to sum up...
Sesta
Pasta has been created claiming that they want to reduce sex trafficking that has been promoted through different sites. For example, Craigslist was this really, really big site. And a lot of sex workers used Craigslist in order to advertise and to get clients, and also often to get in touch with clients online before they would meet them personally. So there was also this network where sex workers could warn each other about people that were potentially dangerous. And also they could, you know, talk to them, and maybe they would already realize someone could be potentially dangerous or something would be off. And those people, because platforms would be basically prohibited to publish such content anymore, those people were forced to go back and provide their services directly on the street, so they would no longer have this free access to talking to clients before meeting them. And the numbers, sadly, have really shown that sex trafficking, which means involuntarily enforced sexual labor of both adults and minors, has not decreased since. It actually, I think, has increased. And what's mainly increased is the unsafety of sex workers who do their job voluntarily but are being robbed of online platforms. And, while this is really shitty, it doesn't mean that they don't do anything about it. And so they are trying to educate themselves on how to safely navigate the internet. So hacking and hustling has been mentioned by Selena the Stripper in the video we just watched before. And they posted this educational slide talking about Earn It. Now, Earn It is kind of like the next act that has not yet been decided on, but is in debate of being... decided to. An Earn It Act is basically that platforms on the internet have to earn the trust of the government, and that basically every transaction, everything is monitored by the government that's happening online. Which, of course, would mean even a deeper cut for sex workers and every kind of marginalized community. And so they posted a few harm reduction tips in case that it gets signed into law. Please remember, we don't all trade sex under the same circumstances, and not all of us have access to the same online tools. Not all of this may be applicable to you or how you work, so please take whatever is useful, ignore the rest, and take care of each other. So basically, social media is not a stable platform for sex workers. We are shadow banned and lose accounts at a significantly higher rate than our peers. Having multiple ways to stay in touch with clients and community can help in the event of losing one account. So it is important to stay connected. Start collecting email addresses and build a mailing list. Having a list of how to get in touch with clients and community is helpful in case you lose one. Back your shit up. This also counts for artists. Download backups and everything of everything. You can archive your social media posts, Google Drive docs, website text, images. Keep multiple backups if you can, including a hard drive. Direct clients to your email. Ask clients what the best way is to stay in touch. Make sure your favorite clients know how to get in touch with you. So the thing of favorite clients is really important for sex workers. So it's not just calling them favorite clients, but it's also calling them regulars. So if you're a stripper, usually you have your regulars that come to the club, which are the people that you usually work with. So you have this, like, you know, group of people that come and consume, and there are kind of unwritten laws also in strip clubs that you kind of leave the regulars to that one person that they belong to, and you don't intervene and try to steal them, kind of. And so you have... It's basically like, I don't know, being a commissionary artist, you have your regular customers that come to you, and they are really important for your survival. So it's the same for sex workers. And if your sex work account is deleted, it's really not your fault. And so while spreading onto different platforms, I think it's really important to realize that basically every social media platform that you know is subversively used for sex work. So this, for example, is a list of subreddits on Reddit that are used to post sexual content, which is quite a fairly long list of subreddits. But it also involves Snapchat. I think that kind of has stopped when Foster Sesta was passed. But before that, Snapchat was also used as a platform to sell online content. Facebook, not really, but like in terms of advertising still. Instagram, of course, and so on. So it's really about trying to be everywhere. And what also happens is that people team up, not just in terms of educating themselves, but also in actively protesting. So, for example, in August there happened Eviction, which was a self-destructing digital art show where sex workers and artists teamed up and basically... So sex workers and artists teamed up and they performed their deletion and their censoring themselves. So they did an intervention that lasted 12 hours and it was really clear that they would be deleted off within those 12 hours. And there are several team-ups, not just between sex workers and artists, but also between sex worker and technicians that create their own structures within the internet for safer work. So, for example, here we have two people from Australia, Lola Hunt and Eliza Sorensen, who are from the Sex Worker and Technologist Collective Assembly 4. And what they did, basically, is they created two sites on their own, one being tris.link, which is being an independent escort site. So it's basically where you book your escorts, but it's structured by sex workers and should provide a much safer environment. And they also created Twitter, which is supposed to be a safer alternative to Twitter, I guess. Depending on the name, which is basically a platform not to directly sell content, but to find clients and distribute them to the place where you're selling your content. And what I also found really interesting is Cypher Sex, which is a queer feminist collective that has whole instruction pages on how to safely navigate the internet, which again... is what I mean with sex workers understand the structures of social media and so on much, much more than we do because they're much more threatened by it. So they basically center their instructions on Eve being an example of a sex worker that saves safely navigates through the internet. So, for example, choosing a name is already one step that's important. So, like many pro-doms, Eve has chosen a work name that sounds cool, but on commercial social networking platforms, her username is Eve Pentest Adams. She has added a real-sounding surname to her work name, and although this sounds boring, there is an important reason. On the internet, platforms that have real name policies, like Facebook, tend to base this judgment on an individual's legal name, rather than allowing them to identify as they choose. Many companies require both the first name and surname for registration, or a name that doesn't contain any slang terms or profanities. So Eve has added a common surname to her work name. Ultimately, this won't protect her if she falls under the radar of the real name policy enforcers, but automated controls won't spot her name as a potential violation, and she can hope to keep her account for some time. Once she decided on a name, a surname, and a username for her work persona, Eve also did thorough research on various sex work platforms as well as following this guide, so she is sure that nobody else is using that name, at least among sex workers in her city. A phone for each identity, Eve wants to be sure that her work identity can never be connected to her official one, not by stalkers or neighbours or even by state authorities. So creating personas is a really central part of sex work. Some work with different personas, providing different kinds of content and different kinds of aesthetics. Some stick with only one, but it is, on one side, a way to explore and perform a certain persona, it is also a way of trying to ensure some safety, as again, it is not sure for a lot of safe for a lot of people to come out as a sex worker. And Eve also has tips on emailing. When she started looking for an email provider that would be good to use for work, Eve already knew that there is no such thing as a secure email. By default, emails are not encrypted, and if someone can access the servers where messages are stored, often over several machines belonging to both the sender's and receiver's email provider, they can read everything. This includes investigators, but also a random system administrator who has access to these machines. Eve knew that she would not use her email for any sensitive content, but she still wanted to make sure that her email could not be tapped while in transit. So she only chose among email providers that used HTTPS/TLS encryption, which encrypts connections from her computer to the servers, and she made sure that the TLS encryption was actually working by testing the provider she'd chosen on this webpage. And there's a link of email providers that Eve would choose from. To be contacted by her client, Eve has a ProtonMail account which does encrypt her messages with other ProtonMail users all along the way, so messages are not readable in the servers. However, she doesn't consider this encryption reliable enough because the emails with people who do not have a mailbox on ProtonMail are not encrypted. So, kind of to sum this up, sex workers have to find ways to survive on the internet, and the internet being a vital place to sell work and also a vital place to find a community, to connect and to educate. But while they build these structures, they're also constantly pushed out. So it's really this antagonizing forces. Of one hand, they are able to tell their story, which they aren't able to in, you know, other social spheres, but also they're constantly pushed out. So real machine rights, sex workers were pioneers of the digital realm, but we are now being kicked off the same online spaces we built and inspired. Or to phrase it differently, the internet is just as gentrified as the building you're standing in will be. So to close this lecture, I would like to ask you to maybe consider following these accounts, because they put such an enormous amount of energy into educating people. So Vixen Temple Blog, Pretty Boy Girl, Black Venus in Furs, Haley Hayes Uncensored, Soldiers of Pole, Lisa Spliffsome, Jack the Stripper, Sekra Micro Bikini. And I want to thank them for their incredible labor and free education that kind of helped me to also, you know, work against prejudice that I was socialized with. And if you are in the financial position, maybe also consider donating to Xenia Sexarbeit Fachstelle in Bern or Isla Victoria Zürich or Fitz Zürich, which are all organizations that support sex workers in Switzerland, which are especially in need now during COVID times. And thank you for listening. There will be cake outdoors, there will be drink outdoors. If you have questions, anything, we can talk later. And I'll play a song by Kilani to close this off. You can walk off, you can listen to it still. But Kilani basically was mentioned as someone who is not a sex worker and is a pop artist or a musician, but still doing a great job of being an ally to sex workers. So Thank you for listening and being here, and see you in a few minutes.
This shit so cold should be illegal. Need round two, I need a sequel. Hit the backboard like a freak though. You next level, you a chico. In so deep, you hit my seat plug. Got me singing like Alicia. Got me using all your lingo. Tell your girlfriend that you're single. Call me over cause I go hard. Sweet little bit, feel like a porn star. Next day, act just like your road dog. Bitches asking how you know her. That game's stupid, baby, loca. Too loud, I till la boca. Out this world, you're supernova. Fuck that, I ain't coming over. Come over, can I stop by to see you tonight? Can I stop by to see you? Both on fire, load of teamwork. Leave with juices on your t-shirt. Loud and clean, no need for reverb. Tell the Uber driver, reaper. Flip that bitch and make the U-turn. Sex ain't crazy, need the blooper. Last on line, but you a trooper. Sniper gang, no Bradley Cooper. Hi, I'm hell, it's nice to meet ya. Know you fucking with a demon. Do about anything you please ya. Come inside me, I'm a keeper. Want me to make you a senior. Never been that hard to reach ya. When we done, you say I need ya. I done made you a believer. Come over, can I stop by to see you? Always stop by. You top five, and no, you're not five. And I fuck three or two, but one girl. I'm hot, now I wanna see what's under. The accent's easy in a sundress. Your accent's leaking on my tongue, yes. You're bad, then it's all the same for Mike Jack. I made you come and you came right back. You're calling me up on a late night. I got you leaking like a brake pipe. Swimming in your sea just like a diver. I'm in it just creeping like a great white. And I might fuck you in your own car. You ride my face just like a porn star. Then it's so deep, just call the brochure. And I just want one thing out the phone call, like I'm can I?